Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Rock Bowl here in Dubuque, Iowa, on the campus of Loras College. We're here today for our men's soccer matchup between the Loras College Dewhawks and UW Stevens Point, the Pointers. My name's Brock Booth, and I'm joined today in the booth by Duane Vetter. Duane, what are you excited for in this matchup today?
Two very even matched teams, Brock. I'm really excited to see how this one plays out. You know, you saw me, I'm here, got all my stats laid out in front of me. All signs are pointing to this being a really tight matchup that's they're going to rely heavily on their goalkeepers. That I'm excited to see the match play out.
Yeah, so what are some starters that you want to look at when you're looking at UW Stevens Point? Because obviously these guys coming from the middle of Wisconsin, not an ARC team that Loras has seen ever, actually. It's the first meeting between these two schools. So what should we look for today with the UW Stevens Point Pointers?
Well, as mentioned, I look at Jacob Havlick, the goalkeeper for the Pointers. In 13 games played, Brock, he has 9 goals allowed for a goal allowed average of 0.73 per game. That comes with 53 saves for a save percentage of 0.855, Brock.
Yeah, that's an incredible total. And not only can these guys really get it done on the defensive end, but these guys are very aggressive offensively, right? So 31 goals on the season throughout the first 13 games. That's not only second best in the WIAC, where they're from, the Wisconsin Intercollegiate Athletic Conference, but they're tied for 24th in all of NCAA Division III in straight-up scoring goals. And, I mean, obviously, at the end of the day, that's not all that this is about, but getting shots out there and being super aggressive on offense is a huge deal. And UW-Stevens Point not only takes care of stuff defensively, but they get the job done on offense as well. So we have a kickoff down over towards the 15-yard line. UW Stevens Point is fighting for it with Loras. It'll head out of bounds, and we are going to have our first throw-in so far in the game. For the Dewhawks, who are you looking for to have a nice game today?
They're going to rely heavily, as mentioned, on Beg Krogman, the goalie. Looking at his stats compared to Jacob Havlick's, Ben Krogman has played 10 games, got the start in 10 of them, with a goal allowed average of 1.23, 12 goals allowed. He has 40 saves on the season for a save percentage of 0.769. Otherwise, offensively, they're going to rely heavily on Reed Miklovich and Danny Galeana-Torres.
Yeah, Danny Galeana-Torres has been off to a really, really hot start. Coming into the season, when you were looking at it, Reed Miklovich, obviously last year, 2023 offensive MVP in the ARC, right? So he's going to make a lot of things happen on offense. But Danny Galeana-Torres has the goals right now, 5 goals on the season, which has been an incredible total. It was a big improvement from last year, in which Danny Galeana-Torres only scored 2 goals in total. So it's been kind of a quiet start for Reed Miklovich. So I really think today could be a bounce back day for him. So it's going to be a throw in now around the 25-yard line. For the Dewhawks, who have possession, they are going off to the left side of your screen, and they're wearing their all-white uniforms versus UW Stevens Point. They're wearing their all-purple uniforms. Can get a little can misconstrue some viewers here or there. Obviously, the Dewhawks wearing purple most of the time themselves. But, yeah, this is the first matchup between these two schools, and I thought it was really interesting when you were looking at it, Duane, that this is the first season ever for UW Stevens Point men's soccer. It was just added this year for them. So, I mean, how do you think their start has been for a school that's just beginning in men's soccer?
Oh, absolutely phenomenal, Brock. I mean, if you're a school that just started, think about all the football programs that make the jump up to D1 and have their first season. That's what I'm going to compare it to. You expect them to be at best like 500. At the worst, they might not even win a game at all. So for UW Stevens Point to come into this game with a record of 8-2-3, that is beyond impressive, Brock.
And not only are they coming into this one at 8-2-3, they're being led by a former Loras alum. It's Jordan Kaiser that's entering his first season at the helm of UW Stevens Point. The first season, obviously, in program history, but Kaiser was here for at least one season as an assistant coach for both men's and women's. So he's seen a lot of success. He knows what it takes to be a successful program. Obviously, the women's team has been tearing it up. So far, they're 11-0, and they're sitting at number 16 in the country. But the men's team is also super competitive and very good themselves at 5-3-5. And last year, they were number 1 in the ARC and all that kind of stuff. So it's a foul over here that just got called, and we're waiting for the ball to be moved back to the initial spot as it did get moved ahead. So good on the goalkeeper there, Jacob Havlick, to move it back to keep the pace of play going, get this game super exciting. So obviously, Loras has been successful so far. They're 2-0-3, though, in their last 5 games. So what do you think they have to do today to try and finish this one off and get into the win column as opposed to maybe getting a tie?
Just strong defense. You got to help your goalie out. I mean, I mentioned Ben Krogman's save percentage, but they just really want to put the pressure on the other team, get some defensive stops, score some goals of their own offensive-wise, and just keep the pressure on UW-Stevens Point.
And typically these games, too, super exciting games that the men's soccer team plays. Only one game we've seen all season where the Duhawks and their opponent have combined for less than two goals. That was a 1-0 victory for Loras when they were playing Dominican here at the Rock Bowl, but there's been a lot of success throughout the years for the Duhawks here at the Rock Bowl. 79-18-8 at home over the past 10 years. What do they have to do today to make sure that they can keep that win streak going?
Kind of the exact same thing I just said with keeping the pressure on UW-Stevens Point. I mean, you look at a lot of Loras's wins. They are those 2-1 versus Dominican, 2-1 versus Aurora, excuse me, 1-0 versus Dominican, Concordia, Wisconsin, 2-1. And then the outlier would be that 5-0 victory over Buena Vista.
Yeah, and they've gotten off to a lot of very slow starts. Even in that Buena Vista game when they won 5-0, they scored one goal in the first half before scoring four in the second half. So it's a team that, aside from actually homecoming night the other night, which was also senior night for the players, they don't typically get off to hot starts. They got off to a 2-0 lead there in the first half, never looked back, won against Nebraska Wesleyan 2-0. As we have the ball out on the far side near the net, they're going to call out off of Loras, and so it will be a goal kick now for the Pointers. So it's just a matter of staying competitive, right, and making sure that the defense is on, because you want to limit the goals. And UW-Stevens Point, I mean, obviously, Stevens Point is a team that can put them up in a hurry, and making sure that you maybe get an early goal to get that confidence boost for your offense, I think, is going to be a huge key in the game. So a foul on the field. We're about the 45-yard line here for UW-Stevens Point, who's worked it into Duhawk territory. And also another thing I want to see from Loras, which they almost struggled a little bit with Nebraska Wesleyan, especially later on in the game, as this is going to be kicked into the penalty box. A header attempt there from UW-Stevens Point is no good, and we're going to move it back up the field a little ways. We're around the 45-yard line with possession for the Duhawks. There's a fight for it on the far side, now around the 40. Fight for the ball, and the Pointers come away with it seemingly, but now they're going to kick it back to the Duhawks. We're going to try and set up some offense. They have a lone runner, Diego Rodriguez, on the far side. We're about the 15-yard line. He's working it to the 10, possibly looking to get across into the middle, trying to set it up. This is going to be out, and this is going to be a what looks to be a corner kick called by the referee, and it will be just that. So we're going to have a corner now on the far side.
Good opportunity early here for the Deweys.
And this is a team, too, that gets a lot of corner opportunities themselves. 95 corners on the season, well, now 96, but 95 corners on the season. So they're obviously very aggressive on offense. That's a really nice total. I believe it's 15th in NCAA Division III. This cross into the middle is going to be poked away by Jacob Havlick, who's just going to put that on the other side, and it will roll out. So it's going to be a throw-in now for Loras on the far side. So cross didn't do too much, as Havlick is just going to move it away. So we're going to wait the throw-in, obviously getting a running start here to try and get that in towards the middle. Reed Miklavik is lined up closest, as he is a tall target in the middle there, but this is headed away by UW-Stevens Point and moved back into the middle. So it looks like crisis averted for right now for the Pointers, as they're going to try and set up some early offense. Miklavik has it around the 10-yard line. Left-footed kick is going to sky above the net and back into the rocks. So it will be a goal kick now for UW-Stevens Point. But that's what the Duhawks need to do today, is get the ball, I think, to Reed Miklavik. Feed him. He can make something happen, because even if he's not scoring goals, he is getting a lot of assists. He has 6 assists on the season, so he's making a lot happen. He draws a lot of attention, obviously. So when you're looking at a scouting report, you want to take away Reed Miklavik, but that opens somebody else up. And so far, the beneficiary have been guys like Brian Basinger and Danny Galeana-Torres.
Yeah, and then on the defensive side, Brock, you saw there last time it was Brant Perry making that kick. Look for him and Ethan Kelly, number 3 for the Duhawks, to have a big game. I think that they're both junior players. I think they're both people that the team head coach Koenig is looking at, saying, hey, I need you guys to step up. You need to have a big game here if we want to win this one.
making sure that they can stop that offensive attack from the pointers as this will be booted into the middle. A pass looking for somebody in the penalty box. This is poked away by Havlik, and now an attempt from Danny Galeana-Torres was a little bit too slow. The defense was able to get there in time to prevent that from turning into anything dangerous there for the pointers, as this is just going to be kicked away and out of bounds. It'll be a throw-in now for the Dewhawks.
Missed opportunity there, Brock.
A missed opportunity indeed. It just looked like it went off the bottom of the foot of Galeana-Torres, and obviously just hit a little bit too slow to where the defenders could react in time to poke that one away. Miklavik now on the far side is going to kick this, trying to cross it into the middle, but it will roll out of bounds, and now a goal kick again for the pointers. So I think it kind of goes without saying, first visit ever for UW Stevens Point to the Rock Bowl, and again, a very menacing place to play. A lot of teams don't come here and win games, and if it is close to getting a win, usually the Dewhawks can at least salvage a tie. So if you're UW Stevens Point, what's the biggest takeaway? What is the biggest goal to try and get a win here today at the Rock Bowl?
The exact opposite of what I said the goal is for Loras. Okay, you want to flip the script and put the pressure on Loras. Here in the Rock Bowl, Loras rarely sees pressure on him, and usually if they do, that's in a 2-1 sort of lead or a 1-0 sort of lead. So if you're at UW Stevens Point, you want to score the first goal, you want to score especially the second goal. Keep that pressure on the Dewhawks.
So we're waiting the throw in now for the Dewhawks. They're wearing all white, the Stevens Point pointers in all purple, as this throw in the middle is going to get past the goalkeeper, and that will be a throw-in goal for the Dewhawks. A 1-0 lead here early.
Wonderful, wonderful job done there by the Dewhawks. And the goalie just, I don't know how else to describe it, but he missed. He missed grabbing the ball.
He did. He just straight up whiffed, and it's to the benefit of the Dewhawks, who now have a 1-0 lead. A very unorthodox goal for the Dewhawks to get this one started, but again, 1-0.
That's exactly it. That's your guy, Brock, taking advantage of the opportunity.
So Brian Basinger with the goal, and that's his fourth of the season. And the great thing about that being his fourth goal, that's the most goals he's ever scored in a single season. So congratulations to Brian Basinger, and there's a lot of season left. So he could definitely get even more than that, just adding on to that total. And he's obviously a guy that he's been there for a really long time for Loras, and he's provided a lot of extremely beneficial stats and whatnot. He really gets out there and he does his job, and that's just been Brian Basinger for years on years for the Dewhawks, as this is going to be kicked out of bounds. It goes off of the gloves of Havlik, so it will be a corner kick now for the Dewhawks on the far side.
And that's one of Loras' biggest strengths, Brock, is the age and the experience of their roster. A lot of juniors, a lot of seniors down the board. Like you mentioned, Basinger's a senior. Diego Rodriguez is a senior. Ben Krogman's a redshirt senior.
The cross into the middle by Havlik is going to be controlled. It's controlled by Havlik. The cross was by Miklavic, as this is going to be booted out now by the pointers, who, with a little bit of a flick, are looking to try and get this away and find some form of offense. So they're waiting for their offense to set up. Dewhawk defense is a swarming one. Typically, teams don't have a lot of opportunities on net. Pointers have it on the left side. Now in towards the penalty box, still on the left side, as this is going to be poked away by the Dewhawks. That was Brant Perry, the guy you were just talking about, with the poke away. It will be a corner now for the pointers on the far side.
Yeah, now I bring up Brant. I got the chance to talk to him before class, after class on Monday, and he's just such a humble kid. So nice to talk to him and ask him questions about the team, what he thinks about the week, the schedule for that week, and just such a great kid.
Cross into the middle is a little bit dangerous here for the Dewhawks, who haven't been able to clear it yet. It goes straight to a pointer player, but now the Dewhawks are going to try and clear this away. Still in the danger zone here around the 15-yard line. The Dewhawks have possession, and Miklavic, veteran move, he's just going to boot this away so that they can set up their defense. And like you're talking about, I totally agree with you on the classes coming into a huge, huge prevalent, it's going to be a huge point of emphasis here in this game, as The Duhawks, obviously an older team. Obviously, they have a lot more experienced players. The Pointers rely a lot more on freshmen and a lot more on transfers. Obviously, it's the first year of the program, so that is going to be the case. But nonetheless, it is a point of emphasis.
Yeah, and I'm glad you bring that up, because you look at the Pointers roster. They have one junior on roster. Everyone else is a freshman or sophomore. That one junior is number 25, Buck Siebert. That is a fantastic name. I love that name. But, yeah, you're right. I mean, that's the expectation for a team that's in its first year. You expect it to be sophomores and freshmen.
And the nice thing to see if you are Coach Kazer is these guys are showing out. These guys are showing up. They're ready to play. It's not like it's a deer in a headlight moment every week when they go from game to game. These guys are ready to go. They obviously have a great record, but more than this, their freshman, Devin Wilkerson, a guy from La Crosse, Wisconsin, so far this year he has 8 goals, which is tied for 35th in all of NCAA Division III, and it's second in the WEAC. Obviously, the number one guy in the WEAC is a man from UW-Eau Claire who I saw had 16 goals, so he doubled Wilkerson's total. It's going to be hard for Wilkerson to catch that. But as a freshman, getting 8 goals, I understand some of that's just being in the right place at the right time, but it also takes a lot of skill to put it into the back of the net. And so it's been really impressive for Wilkerson, a freshman, to get out there. 8 goals, 20 individual points. He has a 50% shot on goal percentage, so obviously showing out.
And you can't forget his 4 assists too, to account for 12 total goals as a freshman, especially. Like, I would not be surprised if in my years of broadcasting, like 2 years down the road, 3 years down the road, I see his name on the All-American list.
I wouldn't be shocked either. I think that's a really good analysis, as now the Duhawks have it. They're fighting for it, at least on this near side, as it will belong to the Pointers, who will have a throw-in. Looked like that could have been off the Duhawks, but nonetheless, now a header here from Basinger close to the camera, as we are going to have a foul now on the Pointers, and the Duhawks will have it around the 50-yard line.
Yeah, it was enough contact there. I agree with the call. Knocked him to the ground as he was trying to land.
This is going to be kicked right into the middle. Havlik is going to try and punch it away. Could have been a dangerous situation here, but the Duhawks now have it. They're going to try and pass it over towards the near left side. Diego Rodriguez was the intended target of the pass, but the Duhawks could not connect. And now the Stevens Point Pointers will have a throw-in again. It's still on their side of the field, though, so if you're the Duhawks, you do like to see that. We're now around the 40, and that was a header off of Stevens Point. So the Duhawks will have a throw-in around the 50-yard line.
Yeah, it was just off enough with that pass. It was close, a close miss, but led him too far to the sidelines.
And it's one of the toughest things to do in soccer is get that connection really going, especially on a lead pass like that when a guy's taken off and you're trying to hit him perfectly. We've only seen it a couple times, actually. It was in the men's game the other night at homecoming and senior night against Nebraska Wesleyan that we saw one of those perfect connections, and it was a header goal for Brian Basinger, which was incredible to see. But it's kind of a once-in-a-lifetime – it's not once-in-a-lifetime thing, but almost once-in-a-game type of thing. And that's – you know, you don't see it very often. It's just hard to do. McLovick with it around the 35-yard line. The Duhawks still have it on the far side as Galeana Torres was fighting for it over there. A lot of aggressive play here between the Pointers and the Duhawks, and this will be a foul now on the Duhawks, and so the Pointers will have it around midfield.
There is a lot of physicality going on down there, a lot of contact. Refs are on top of it, though, doing a good job out there.
I agree. I think they've reffed it well so far, because sometimes you don't want to over-aggressively ref and take over a game, but sometimes that's also necessary, especially if you have two physical teams like Stevens Point and Loras. Loras, both teams, the men's and women's team, are very aggressive. They do have a lot of fouls. The Duhawks actually lead the ARC in yellow cards. So, I mean, maybe not a stat you want to lead the ARC in, but nonetheless, they're very, very aggressive. And so making sure you're not overbearing, but you're still reffing fair is the important thing. And thus far, they've been doing just that. But obviously, a lot of game left. Kicked away here for the Duhawks. We're around the 40. Basinger has it on the near side, working his way up. Now he's working it towards the middle. A good move there. Passes out to Rodriguez on the outside. Rodriguez kicks it into the middle on the ground. This is a kick into the back of the net And that will be a goal for the Duhawks off on the right side. And the Duhawks lead it 2-0.
Great play, great find, just great all around there, Brock. That was brilliant by the Duhawk offense. That was, I believe, Danny Galeano-Torres. So once again, it's sort of a quiet game for Reed McClobbick, but it's Brian Basinger and Danny Galeano-Torres taking advantage of it.
They've been beneficiaries all season of passes like that and finding ways open. Rodriguez has it on the near side as he gains possession, prevents it from going out of bounds. Now he's going to work the ball around on the near side. This has been the ideal start for the Duhawks to get out on top of a young team like this and really take control, especially at home, is vital. They weren't allowing UW-Stevens Point to get anything going. Obviously, the first goal, a little bit of a mishap, whatever, but you're going to take that no matter what. And so far, the Duhawks have been taking advantage.
Definitely. Like I said, put the pressure on them early, and they're doing just that.
So we're waiting for the corners. I have my head poking out of the window. This corner is a little bit long, and it doesn't reach any Duhawk target as it's just going to go out of bounds. Does bounce off the head of a Duhawk, and thus it will be a goal kick now for the Pointers. Thought I was about to fall out of the window there for half a second.
Oh, I got quick reflexes. I would have caught you.
I was leaning a little bit too far out, Duane. Fight for it on the near side, but the Pointers will have it around the 40. Trying to win the one-on-one battle, and the Pointers do just that. They find a man in the middle, still working it towards the middle. The pass is just a little bit too far ahead where the Duhawks could kick it away. Now they'll have it around midfield. We're about the 35-yard line. Now they're working its way up, trying to get it to Reed McClavick, who stands in the middle, brings a lot of attention to him. Now we're on the far right side with Danny Galeano-Torres, who is fighting with his man to try and create a little bit of space. He does just that, still out on that far side, and this is going to be crossed into the middle right into the waiting arms of Havlick.
Yeah, nothing fancy there, just trying to see what they can find. A great job by Jacob Havlick to grab that one.
Kicked away here for the Pointers, around the 30. And now kicked ahead. A lead pass for the Duhawks is not going to come through, so the Pointers will have a throw-in on their side. Pointers came into today with 4 straight wins. So they beat UW Stout 1-0. That was what started the streak. And then they beat River Falls 2-0, Beloit 5-1, and Stout again 2-0. The weird thing about the schedule, though, is that first game against UW Stout, although those guys are in the same conference, that first game between the two was not a conference game. They are only 1-0 in the WEAC. So the second time they played UW Stout, that was the conference game. But nonetheless, they won both.
Kind of curious with that. Was that mean UW Stout was scheduled before they joined the WEAC? Because it has a similar situation happened Utah and whoever played before, they were both Big 12 schools, so it wasn't a Big 12 conference game. That's the only thing I could think of, at least.
Something similar to that. Maybe it could be something with how they're a first-year team, and so maybe they had to figure out people to play on their schedule. Maybe
right.
People didn't even want to play them. You know, oh, you're a first-year program, maybe not. But that's all up to speculation, right?
Exactly.
So a throw-in here for the Pointers around the 15.
Schedule is interesting. I was trying to find similar opponents. They only have one shared opponent, and that is Concordia, Wisconsin. Stevens Point, that was a 1-0 victory for the Pointers, and Loras, it was a 2-1 victory for the Duhawks.
Throwing into the middle isn't going to cause any trouble, as this one will just roll right out, and Krogman will have the kick for the Duhawks. But yeah, I saw the exact same thing, and it is important, though, if you don't really have a baseline, to kind of look at some of those games and analyze them, but you can't do it too much, right? Because obviously the theory that, oh, this team beats this team, so this team's better than this team, is just not, you know, that's A plus B doesn't always equal C in that kind of situation, you know what I mean?
Exactly. You got to take into account seasons going on, especially there early in the season. the Wisconsin-Stephen Point Concordia-Wisconsin game was September 8th. And meanwhile, the Dewhawks played Concordia-Wisconsin September 11th. So actually way closer than I at first thought, but still things change game to game. So
a lot of changes game to game. I totally agree with you. And another thing on top of that, too, as this is kicked into the middle, which could cause a problem. Here's it's batted straight into the air by the pointers. But no action here for the Dewhawks. They still have it on the near side. They're going to just let it roll out so they will have a throw-in. But what I was saying before is it is important to think of things like that. This is a young team. And so young teams might suffer from a little bit of inconsistency from time to time. And so with Stevens Point, you don't know maybe what you're going to get day-to-day because they are so young. They are a bunch of freshmen and juniors. So we're still waiting for the throw-in on the near side. Now getting the run-up for the Dewhawks. This throw is going to be right into the middle. Havlick's going to try and punch it away. It finds a Dewhawk who's going to try and left foot kick this one into the middle. Dewhawk still fighting for it in the penalty box. A man falls down. No call. This is going to be kicked out around midfield, so the Dewhawks will have it, but the pointers are trying to create some quick offense. Still around the 50, now around the 45. It belongs to Diego Rodriguez on the near side. Finds Brightson on a lead pass. Now kicked into the middle. Finds McLovick, a really good connection. This could be dangerous. McLovick is good with his left foot. He's trying to set that up. Now across into the middle, and it's going to be batted away by the pointers, and a crisis averted there for the pointers.
And that was some great defense there by the pointers. I wish I had a pair of binoculars so I could give that player his dues. I can't quite see the number. It's a little hard to see from the stands yeah. up here, but great defensive play there. You saw Miklovic pass. And the attempt, like he was trying to get the header, and the defender was all over it.
I found if I squint just hard enough, I can see the numbers a lot less. So it's pretty tough. The pointers have it around the 20-yard line. Now they're going to boot it around midfield. Belongs to the Dewhawks wearing white. Still working around are the Dewhawks, but now they find a lane. Around the outside, a kick into the middle is not going to do anything there for the Dewhawks. It's well defended by the pointers as this is going to go out off of Loras. We're sitting with around 20 minutes left here in the first half. The score is 2-0 in favor of the Dewhawks. We saw a bit of an incidental goal to start us off in this one with a Brian Basinger throw-in that hit the back of the net, and then we saw another goal later on by Danny Galeana-Torres. So it's been an eventful first half for the Dewhawks, but an ideal start as well.
That it has. This game is flying by. Haven't been a lot of stops in the clock either.
Which is nice. You like to see a nice fast pace of play, regardless of what sport you're playing, right? And you don't want to see a lot of stoppages because usually that implies injuries or fouls, things of that nature. It will be off of UW Stevens Point around the 20-yard line. Dewhawks working fast on the far side. This is going to be a left-footed kick into the middle. Had a Dewhawk, but they couldn't quite time up the run in into the middle, as now the pointers are going to try and move this forward. The Dewhawks are fighting for it. Still around the 35-yard line as a pointer will fall down, and a foul now on the Dewhawks. Just as we had talked about limiting the fouls, there's a foul right there, but really not that severe of a foul nonetheless. Ben Krogman will collect this as it's just hit right to him. So now a goal kick for the Dewhawks.
Yeah, that was just an incidental foul. That's why it wasn't a stoppage of the clock. They just run into each other, get tangled up. And that it's soccer. That's bound to happen sometimes.
Absolutely. When you got two teams playing so hard and two very aggressive teams at that, obviously it's bound to happen from time to time. A flick ahead attempted here by the pointers. And now the Dewhawks are going to try and work this onto their defensive half, but it's a foul on the pointers, and so the Dewhawks will have a free kick around midfield.
And I tell you what, I don't know many athletes here at Loras College who have as much hustle as Brian Basinger. You'll see him on both ends of the field just making hustle plays.
And you want guys like that. Obviously, every team ideally wants guys like that, but a leader in Brian Basinger that's not only a senior and a guy that brings a lot of experience to the table, but more than that, a guy that will show you hustle. He's going to lead by example. You need guys like that on your team, and the Dewhawks are really lucky to have a guy like Brian Basinger. So a volley of kicks between both teams. Still awaiting for a team to come up definitively with control as two players will run into each other. The Pointers have it. They're going to try and work this offensively, but they can't control it. Now it'll be worked back around the 40-yard line. Reed McLovick has it now, who takes control. They couldn't connect with Diego Rodriguez. A good read here by the defender for UW-Stevens Point. Now they're going to work it on the near side. And a good opportunity for the Pointers. We're around the 5-yard line, across into the middle. Is defended well by the Duhawks. It's headed away by Dana Galeano-Torres. And now the Duhawks will kick it ahead, looking for Reed McLovick, but he wasn't in the right spot. So the Pointers are going to still work it into Duhawk territory even further.
That was Carson Woods for the Duhawks, kicking it out of there.
An attempt on goal is easily defended by Krogman, and so we will wait for the Duhawks to set up their offense. Haven't seen a lot of good shots on goal thus far for the Pointers, which is a testament to the Duhawk defense, but it's also out of the ordinary for UW-Stevens Point, as these guys came in 202 shots per game and 101 of those being shots on goal. So when they do get shots, they're competitive shots that are forcing the goalkeeper to at least move around or make an attempt on the ball. Third in the WEAC in shots on goal, tied for 53rd in all of Division III. So they are a good team at being aggressive and getting shots on goal. We just haven't seen any of that yet.
Yeah, and a big testament to that has been Loras' defense hasn't really given them many opportunities to set up for the amount of shots that they'd like to.
So a fight for it between both teams. Still waiting for one team to definitively come up with possession. Now McLovick has it, and he's working his way back into Duhawk territory, was trying to get it into the middle. He was fouled on the play by the Pointers, so we will have a free kick around midfield.
Coming up on the 15-minute mark now, we're at 15:50 right now. And yeah, same thing there. Wasn't any malice in that attempt, just a physical play, and foul gets called.
So we're awaiting the free kick from Ethan Kelly, as this is booted away on towards the far side. Belongs to the Pointers, if only briefly. Now they're going to try and set up some form of offense, but it's headed away by Brant Perry in the middle. Kicked ahead and out of bounds, and so the Duhawks will have it on a throw-in. Trying to extend that 2-0 lead here with just under 15 minutes left to go in the first half. A couple substitutions for both teams, as now we will have a throw-in. This throw-in finds a Pointer, as now the Pointers are going to try and set up some quick offense. They get it into the middle. Could have been a dangerous situation there, as he had two men going, one to his left and one to his right, and he had an option there in the middle, but well defended there by the Duhawks to just kick that away so that they could better set up the defense, because the guy on the right was wide open right there for a second. It could have been a free run at the net, which would have forced Krogman into some action, as we really haven't seen him have to do too much so far.
Yeah, but it also would have taken a split-second decision. Like you said, it was only a split second he was open, so great response by the defense.
Throw in now for the Pointers in purple. It's going to go right to a Duhawk, who heads it out from the penalty box. Now a cross attempted into the middle is going to bounce off the crossbar. Hits a man in the back of the head, and we will reset. So field goal just a little bit short for the Pointers.
Got our own double doink off the upright off the head.
So now Krogman will boot this away. You know what always amazes me, as maybe this is coming from a guy from a little bit of being naive as a guy that doesn't necessarily play soccer, but I cannot believe how far these goalkeepers can kick the ball. I just can't believe it. I saw in the men's and women's game, I saw Kendall Kells boot one like 70 yards, and she made it look easy. And I've seen Krogman do the exact same thing. Just baffles me a little bit. I don't know. A little bit of a sidebar, but it just blows me away.
Definitely something I noticed too. I come from small town Iowa. We didn't even have a soccer team in high school, so wasn't very familiar with the game either when I got here to Loras, and I've also been blown away by the likes of Kendall Kells and Ben Krogman my 2 years so far.
We are blessed here at Loras to have two incredible goalkeepers, both for men's and women's, as Kendall Kells likely will go down as the greatest goalkeeper in Loras women's soccer history. And Ben Krogman has provided a lot. He's in the Loras history books as well. So both of these guys, well, Kendall Kells and Ben Krogman, have provided a lot for their respective programs here at Loras. Duhawks have it around the 30, still trying to set up some offense here, as now this will be kicked away.
Almost took out Jill down there on the sidelines.
Jill had to duck, I think. I hope she's okay. But she's manning camera three, or she's helping man camera three right now. So
she knows. She knows. She has her head on a swivel.
When you're doing football and soccer, you're bound to get run into from time to time. We've seen it before, but Jill's okay right now. She hasn't gotten hit yet. But that's, of course, TBD. I don't want to jinx anything.
I'll never forget my first game working sideline cam for football and nearly getting trucked by Simpson's quarterback.
I bet that was a bit of an experience, right?
Yeah. Could have broke my collarbone, but, you know, we do anything for this.
So that's going to go out off of the Duhawks. It will be a goal kick here for the Pointers.
See how far he kicks it, Brock. See how far this goal kick goes.
Yeah, we can measure this right here. It's not Havlik taking the kick, but even more impressive, that just went 60 yards in the air. So nonetheless, even if it's goalkeeper or not, I mean, these guys can all boot it. I'm a little bit jealous, to say the least, because I really don't know how far I could kick a soccer ball, and I don't think it would be 60 yards if I had to just take a wild guess here.
Just got to get in the weight room, start hitting the leg day more.
Yeah. No kidding. I do need to hit the weights a little bit, man. Pointers with it around the 30. A volley between both squads as both teams are vying for possession, as this will now go out of bounds off of the Pointers. We have around 10 minutes left to go, 10 and a half minutes, just under that total here in the first half. And the Duhawks lead it 2-0 after a goal from Brian Basinger and a follow-up goal from Danny Galeana-Torres. As now a running throw in here for the Duhawks. A good toss into the middle, does almost find a Duhawk. Now it's still around that penalty box area. Could be dangerous for the Pointers. Duhawks trying to find somebody in the middle. It will roll out of bounds off of the Deweys, and now it will be a goal kick for the Pointers.
Got another substitution here for the Duhawks. See, that's going out. Like I said, really hard to see from up here.
It is tough. Not having binoculars is tough to see some of the numbers and see who's going in and who's going out, especially with this dark purple uniforms that Stevens Point are running as well, even though they do have the yellow lettering on the side. Still tough to see, and the Duhawks obviously in white with a little bit of smaller numbers.
Right, under 9:30 now here in the first half.
Pass into the middle was a good one here. Finds a Duhawk. Now we're still around in the middle of the penalty box. The pass was out to number 41 there, as this is going to be worked by the Deweys. Working it into the middle. This is a kick that's on the ground off to the right side, and that will just miss.
That was some really good defense from the Pointers right there.
So I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that was actually number 45. That's Sepp Hierkens, the freshman from Tilburg, Noord-Brabant. That's Southern Netherlands. So obviously the Duhawks utilize guys, Sepp Hierkens, Danny Galeana-Torres, to name a couple. We utilize these type of guys all the time. What do you think that these international guys bring to the table?
Just their experience. You know, soccer in America, soccer across the sea, it's so much bigger of a deal over there that, you know, there's a lot of experience. They have a lot of, you know, tips and other things they can bring and really give to those other players.
And the competitive scene in the international scene is a lot more competitive, as we were just kind of saying. I guess in America, soccer isn't as, I guess, a big of a deal, and I say that in air quotes because it is still a big deal. as now we're going to take a look at the replay here.
Looking at the foul that occurred there in the penalty box. You could see them just run into each other, trip over one another.
So this is just going to be booted away here by the pointers. But as I was saying, a little bit more competitive in the international scene than opposed to the American scene. And these guys do bring a lot to Loras. And I have a chance to talk to Danny Galliano-Torres. I have him in a couple of my classes, and he's incredible. He's a great guy to get to talk to, and he knows a lot about the game as well. So that definitely plays a factor in adding some experience to the Duhawks. Even though he is just a junior, he does bring a lot, and he's worked competitively in the international scene, as he is from Madrid, Spain. So they obviously take soccer a little bit it's a lot bigger of a deal over there.
Right, and that doesn't just go for Danny Galliano-Torres. Any of the players, really, they're always so open. If you want to talk to them, just talk soccer with them, they're always so opening, so willing to just share their wisdom and what they've learned.
And it's nice to see, too, that the Duhawks and Loras College in general bring a lot of guys in from the international scene. No matter the sport, we see it in all types of sports. Loras just got a bunch of recruits that are from Colombia. They were directly from Colombia. These guys bring a lot to the table, and they add a lot to the culture of Loras, and we see it all the time as both the men's and women's soccer team also celebrate Somos Duhawks Night. So obviously they do celebrate things like that, as we're going to work around the 10-yard line here. Stevens Point is trying to kick this one away. They do just that, as it will roll. It almost rolls out of bounds. Saved to inbounds here by Stevens Point, who's looking to try and cross this in the middle. They do just that, but it finds a Duhawk instead of the intended target. Now the Duhawks are going to try and clear this away.
That was some great hustle there, number 19 for the pointers. That's Aaron Krishna. I hope I'm saying that right.
Duhawks still have it on the far side, trying to make something happen in the middle. Havlik can't body it up. It rolls right to the Duhawks, an attempt on goal. Another one here, couple ricochets, good defense from the pointers. And now they will try and clear this away, as it will be out of bounds. A throw in now for the Duhawks on the far side. Great defense from UW Stevens Point.
Yeah. We're approaching the 5-minute, 30-second mark right now, but that's exactly why they've won 8 games. They're 8-2-3. Is defensive plays like that, Brock.
Yeah, only 9 goals allowed on the season coming into today, so 0.69 goals per game. I mean, that's an incredible total when you're discussing defensive efforts across the entirety of all of Division III. They rank 35th in total goals allowed, so. But that also is a testament to how good the Duhawk offense has been playing today, as they already have 2 goals and we're only in the first half.
Like, we'll have a corner kick now for the Duhawks. I tell you, if there's one thing that could define both the Duhawk men's and women's soccer team, it's the amount of corner kicks they draw.
They do both draw. I know that the Loras women's soccer team is number 1 in the entire country in forcing corner kicks, and the Duhawks men's team, of course, 12th in all of Division 3. So these guys, super aggressive, and corners, although some people may look at it and think, oh, corners aren't that big of a deal, you know, it's just, you're just kicking it out of the corner, what does it mean? Well, that's a good chance for you to set up some offense, and obviously you're going to do that in practice, and you're going to practice little plays after you kick it out of the corner, and so that allows the Duhawks to set up some offense, and it creates a really good opportunity to try and score a goal. Duhawks work it into the middle, and a bicycle kick attempt there from the Duhawks is going to sky through the uprights behind the net, so no good on the attempt there for the Duhawks, but you love to see the effort.
Yeah, bicycle kick is always so much fun, like, especially when they go in. I've seen it only twice in my 2 years working for soccer. I've only seen it twice, and I tell you, it's really impressive when it happens.
So we're going to take a look at the replay of the bicycle kick here. So now a throw-in for the Duhawks on the near side. Ethan Kelly possesses it, as this throw-in is just going to find a flying UW Stevens Point defender. still working between both squads on the near side around the 40-yard line as they are just going to kick this out of bounds. We'll see a throw-in for the Pointers. A volley of headers between both squads as UW-Stevens Point is going to try and kick this away, get some early offense, force some pressure on the Duhawk defense that we haven't seen in quite a while as Basinger is now going to try and kick this away over towards the right side. It belongs to the Duhawks. It was a nifty move there by the Duhawk player on the far side, but it just runs right into Havlick, who possesses it, and now both teams are fighting for it around the 30. Duhawks with it around the 40-yard line, now working their way up the near side, still fighting for it with the Stevens Point defender, as the Stevens Point defender will fall down onto the ball, and it will belong to Stevens Point. That is a foul, so the Pointers will regain possession. They'll boot it away to around the 35. It does still belong to the Pointers in purple.
Under 2 minutes now left in this half. So not a lot of time for the Pointers to try and get something going. You can see them trying to set up offense here, Brock.
Yeah, you can definitely see them trying to set up offense. And what I've seen them doing a lot in this game so far, and I guess coming into the game, you're not necessarily thinking this is a focal point or this is exactly what I want to do when you're talking about crossing it into the middle. But I've seen them a lot working on this near side, trying to get it into the middle, and it just hasn't been working. So maybe if they try something on the far side, is this throw-in's going to go right to a Stevens Point defender, but it bounces straight back. So instead of the intended header in towards the goal, they got a little bit more like a flick that went behind him, and it rolls out, and so now Krogman will have it. But I think maybe getting away from that, or maybe spacing it out and moving it towards the far side a couple times, could be more effective for the Pointers, but that's just obviously an observation from myself.
As we hit 1 minute remaining in the half, I'm really curious to see, you hear it there, I'm really curious to see if Loras plays it aggressive or just is content holding the ball until the end of the half. Looks like they're playing aggressive.
A good chance on goal here. Left-footed kick is going to sky just above the crossbar, and it hits off the other crossbar, but no good for the Duhawks, and it'll be a goal kick now for the Pointers. But like you were just talking about, will they play it aggressive? Absolutely they will.
You see it there, just sailed a little bit too high on the replay. Great attempt.
So now Stevens Point possesses it around the 15. An attempt on net is going to fly wide left there, as Krogman had to work a little bit. He was at least close enough to make a move, but nonetheless, it misses wide left. Down to the last 10 seconds here, as Krogman looks like he might just hold on to this and not kick it away. He will do just that. So the Duhawks will take a 2-0 lead into halftime here at the Rock Bowl. And Duane, my only question for you in the second half is, what do the Duhawks have to do to maintain this lead?
Keep the defensive pressure. I mean, we've seen it down there. UW-Stevens Point, they've tried to get things going on offense, but the Duhawk defense has been stout, and they just got to keep that going. They already have the pressure on them. You're up 2-0, so you just expect Loras to keep that defensive pressure up, relying on the guys that have been reliable for the Duhawks, like so Ethan Kelly, Brant Perry on defense, then Brian Basinger and Danny Galeano-Torres on offense.
Stout defense indeed. We're going to head into half. Again, the Duhawks leading it 2-0. Don't go anywhere. You're watching the Duhawk Broadcast Network. Welcome back, everybody, to the Rock Bowl. A 2-0 lead here for Loras College against the UW-Stevens Point Pointers in our men's soccer matchup. I'm Brock Booth. I'm joined today by Duane Vetter, a guy wearing purple and another guy wearing purple, which is always great to see. Always supporting the Duhawks, no matter where I'm at. I just love this purple. Anyway, what are the goals now in the second half for the Duhawks?
Duhawks, like I said here in the beginning of, at the end of the first half, just keep the pressure on UW-Stevens Point. Even if you can just get one more goal, a 3-0 or a 3-goal lead, that is just so much pressure then on Stevens Point, who hasn't had a lot going for them offensively in this game.
And if you're Stevens Point, what is their goal in the second half? Other than maybe getting a lot of offense going early, how do they cut away at this lead?
they just got to get the ball down in the Duhawk side of the field more, down into Duhawk territory. We saw it, and we mentioned it in the first half. They haven't been on their own side of the field very often, which, as you mentioned, for an offensive-powered team like them, is very surprising. It's really a testament to how good the Duhawk defense has been. So I'm excited to see what adjustments they made during that break.
And I think UW-Stevens Point being so well coached also, as this throw-in into the middle could have been dangerous, but it's booted away by Loras here, who is trying to find a man streaking down that left side, but is unable to, as now Stevens Point will have it. I really do think with how good the coaching staff is at UW-Stevens Point, and although the players are freshmen, they're still very good players. It's hard to say from time to time if you have freshmen if it's really going to affect them that much, because these guys have been playing soccer for how long, right? You've been playing soccer since you're 4 or 5. You know the game. You know what you should be doing, even if you are a freshman in college. Now, there's a jump from high school to college. I understand that. But they're already 13 games into the season. I assume these guys have adjusted a little bit. And with that little bit of experience and with their coaching experience, I do think we'll see some good adjustments here from Stevens Point. And we have a little bit so far, but obviously very early on in the second half.
Yeah, I mean, already you saw it there. They started off with the ball down in their side of the field.
And just creating opportunities and putting pressure on the Duhawk defense, who hasn't seen a lot of pressure put on them thus far. As you were talking about in the pregame a little bit, and as we talked about before the game a little bit as well, is they need to put the pressure on the Duhawks because they need to make them feel uncomfortable, right? If you get the Duhawks feeling uncomfortable at their home stadium here at the Rock, well, it's going to make the daunting task of trying to win here a lot less daunting.
That it will. And like I said at the beginning of the game, Loras at home, usually if they're uncomfortable to them is being up 2-1 or 1-0.
And a 2-score lead right now, 2-0 lead, as Krogman will collect this one, or Krogman, excuse me, as he will have it around near the goal, and he will await the Duhawks to get set up. So we mentioned earlier in the broadcast, 79-18-8 over the past 10 years here at the Rock Bowl. It's been a long string of success, and I really think you'll see a lot more of that here today, as, I mean, already a 2-0 lead. It's going to be very difficult here in the second half for the Pointers to come back.
They're setting up. Could be a nice offensive opportunity for them here, though.
Working on the far side, an attempted cross into the middle is well defended by the Duhawks, who are opting to just kick this one away, allow their defense to get set up. The UW-Stevens Point Pointers will get their offense set up as well, but they will have a corner on the far side now.
I'm curious to see what they break out for this corner kick.
Left-footed kick into the middle is batted away by the Duhawks almost immediately, so unsuccessful corner there for the Pointers, but they're going to try it again. It gets out of the outstretched arms of Krogman. It did find a Pointer in the back part of that penalty box, but he just couldn't control it well enough with the header, and it bounces out of bounds. It'll be a goal kick now for the Duhawks.
Yeah, definitely a blown opportunity there for the Pointers. If you're the coach for the Pointers, you're really upset that the goalkeeper's down. That's a golden opportunity to get a goal in, and just unable to make it happen there.
And like you were just talking about, it's very rare that you see Ben Krogman out of position, and he was out of position right there. They had an opportunity. There was a lane to try and find that ball into the back of the net, but they just weren't able to take care of business, and now the Duhawks have it, and they're trying to set up some instant offense.
Yeah, you see the foul there. The Hornets sideline did not agree with that call.
So this is sitting at about the 35. Duhawks wearing white. The UW-Stevens Point Pointers are wearing all purple today, which can be a little bit confusing for some viewers, but just know, Duhawks are in white, UW-Stevens Point in purple. This is a header into the penalty box. The Duhawks still have possession of it, as now they're going to try and work this further into the middle, but it was batted away, if only for a moment. Duhawks still have it. A left-footed attempt on goal is blocked immediately, and the Pointers are going to try and flick this forward and find some offense. It does not work. The Duhawks have it around the 35. A left-footed kick in towards the far corner will find a Duhawk, as there will be a fight for possession around that corner of the field, as they're still fighting between the two of them. Reed McLovick has it. He's going to boot this into the middle. A good left-footed kick, but it is collected by the keeper, Havlick.
Not very often you see the ball just come to a complete stop and sit like it did there.
It was super impressive, though, for McLavic to even have a chance of trying to get a kick off into the middle, trying to cross that into the middle, because he was not only fighting the defender that was right there, he was fighting that hidden second defender, which is the out-of-bounds line. And so it was a fight between those two, but he just ended up winning the battle. He was the more aggressive man, found a cross into the middle. It was a decent one. It at least made Havlik have to move around a little bit, but it was collected relatively easily. Now the right-footed kick in towards the middle. Havlik will sky up and collect it as he will opt to throw this one in. It looked like he was going to try and kick that downfield as far as he could, but instead he throws it into a streaking man on the far side as now the Duhawks will have it around the 30-yard line. McLavic was trying to collect it after it was booted right into the air. Nonetheless, the Duhawks will still have possession.
That was a really good job on that last kick attempt on the goal by Loras, by Reed McLavic, to not hit the goalkeeper.
So out of bounds now, the Duhawks opting to just kick it out, try and get their defense set up so that way UW-Stevens Point doesn't get a decent look on net. Or at least that's what you hope as a coach, is that you have a lot of faith in your defense, that when you're set up versus them getting set up, you're going to win that battle 10 times out of 10. But it just depends on the faith that your coach has in the defense. Obviously, the Duhawks have a lot of faith in their defense, especially with how well they've been playing today. 2-0 lead already.
Definitely. That's a highlight of both Sam Koenig for men's soccer and women's soccer with Matt Pucci. They pride themselves on strong defenses.
And not only are they out here coaching well and putting together good defensive schemes, good offensive schemes, but they're winning games, right? And at the end of the day, it comes down to, can you win? Matt Pucci obviously has almost a 900 winning percentage here at Loras. He has 131 wins, 28 losses, 10 ties to his name. So he's been extremely successful. And Coach Koenig, he's in his second year, so not as big of a sample size as Coach Pucci has, but 17-7-9 at Loras, a 590 winning percentage. You're still getting the job done, and that's all you ask for between the coaches is, can you get in the win column? They both can.
Definitely, and that's something I overlook. I think a lot of people overlook too often is how well Sam Koenig has done coming in here just in his second season, almost making the NCAA tournament last year, this year being favored for a position, the ARC's automatic qualification. So, I mean, just lights out job done by him.
Yeah, 12-4-4 last season in his first year and sitting at 5-3-5 right now. And as I was looking through it and as we were digging into the stats a little bit, five ties, that's tied for the most ties ever in Loras history between both men's and women's soccer. You have to go all the way back to 1995, the last team tied five times. That was the 1995 women's soccer team that tied five times in a season. So the Duhawks haven't been able to find the win column maybe as much as they'd like, but they are avoiding losses, which is also good to see.
Yeah, definitely, and that's a good chance to break that record then, Rock. I mean, we're only a quarter of the way, a third of the way through the season now. Many, many opportunities for more ties, though. If you're Loras, you're hoping for a lot more wins.
Of course, and 5-3-5, nothing to scoff at or anything. I think it's a little bit below maybe what the Duhawks were hoping to be at in this point of the season, and I don't think they're necessarily losing those games. I just think it's about getting over the hump and finding ways to win those games that they've been tying so much. But this is the last non-conference game. The rest of the way, it's all ARC play from here, and so I think the Duhawks will find a lot more success in ARC play. So third time they're playing a team from the WIAC this season, and historically, Loras is actually relatively good against the WIAC when they're playing them. They're 19-16-6 all-time versus the WIAC, but so far in the 2 years under Coach Koenig, they're 0-0-4, as this is going to be a good save from Krogman on the far left side. So Coach Koenig looking for his first win against a team against the WIAC.
See a replay here of the save. A nice diving effort there to make the grab. Setting up well.
So the Duhawks will have possession of it. Following up after that Krogman save on the far side of the field. as this is going to be out of bounds, a header from the Dewhawks, and so it'll be a throw-in now for UW-Stevens Point. So offensively, been a very quiet day for UW-Stevens Point. We haven't really seen much of Wilkerson, or you have Jockumson also that has been really effective all season, 4 goals already for Jockumson, and we haven't seen Hudson much. We haven't really called out their names a whole lot, and I really do think that's a testament to the coaching from Loras, making sure that those guys aren't getting out in space. Just as I say that, though, UW-Stevens Point trying to set something up, but the Dewhawk defense is there to defuse the situation and now maybe turn this into some instant offense, as this is a free run down onto the field. This is a right-footed kick that's going to miss wide right.
Let's talk about the effort there from number 16 for Loras. Great hustle play, did a lot of that on his own. It's Nico Garcia, usually in the defensive side of the ball. You see it there. Makes a nice defensive play to get the takeaway, but then also to take it down the field himself. Just great effort. No words. No notes.
He saw an open lane, and he took it. McLavic feeds it into the middle. It is a little bit far for Brian Basinger, who has it now still on the far side. A fight for it. He's just going to try and kick this off of the Stevens Point player. He does that successfully. It'll be a corner again for the Dewhawks. It's a matter of now who's going to take the corner. McLavic started making his way over, but another Dewhawk is now going out to the far side.